So yeah, we're talking about Karoo blue cranes. Well, in fact, we're actually live in the Karoo at the moment. So I'll be talking more about the Karoo, what it is, where it is, all that kind of stuff. So it's very exciting that Christie's with me right here, right now, in this present time and moment. And Tanya and Laura are also with us. We'll tell you why we're all together at the moment. So I'm the Highland Grass and Field Officer based in the Highland region of South Africa, the grassland biome. And I actually spent 8 years in the Karoo. I have a lot of passion for the Karoo, which is very exciting for me to share this with you tonight and today, and wherever you are, if it's nighttime or afternoon or morning. And so we're right here at the moment in a place called the Isle. I'll show you the map now where that is. And yeah, Christie, more about yourself.
Yeah, my name is Christie Craig, and I'm busy with a PhD looking at blue cranes. Most of my work is focused in the Western Cape, and I'm based in the Western Cape. But a section of my work is based here in the Karoo, and that's what I'm going to be sharing with you today.
So when I lived in the Karoo region, I had to take this photo. I mean, come on, let's see a blue crane in the Karoo. There's a photo of a blue crane in the Karoo. So this is close to a town called Middelburg in the Eastern Cape. And it's actually quite amazing because a lot of people actually phoned me asking for construction cranes when they knew that I was working on cranes. I don't know how they got it mixed up with some of the newspaper articles I used to write. But anyway, when I was saying I am Bradley working on cranes, I think they just misinterpreted and didn't read the whole article. So there's a classic blue crane in the Karoo, and another blue crane in the Karoo, actually a pair of blue cranes in the Karoo, and a typical landscape. So I'm very passionate about the Karoo. It's a very beautiful part of the country, a very underrated part of the country. And in this case, you can see that they're reliant on water very much so, because it's one thing they depend on. They need to drink water as well, and like all of us. And they use the groundwater, which comes from windmills in this case, like this one right here. So a lot of people get the impression the Karoo is relatively flat, and this is a nice example of a section where there's some hills in the background over there as well. So just to get more about our bearings, so the Karoo biome is also the second largest biome in South Africa, and where we are at the moment is in the R, which is in the Northern Cape province. So whack bang in the middle there, where I put the R label on. And there's also, so this is known as the Nama Karoo part of it. You also get the Great, which is the Great Karoo, but you also get the Little Karoo, which is found south of us, and that's mainly in the Western Cape province, and also get the succulent Karoo, which is on the west coast of South Africa, which is made up of succulent plants, as the name suggests. So that's where we are at the moment, the R Northern Cape, South Africa. Now the name Karoo, I mentioned now about being a bit like dry on that, so it's a semi-desert, also semi-arid area. The name actually comes from the local language, which means a dry or a hard or a place of thirst. So in other words, the word dry comes out there, as you can see. And the spelling has changed over the years from the Kuru, or I won't try and pronounce that, but that other word as well, the Karoo in that case. And the rainfall is something that you appreciate when you live here and when you work here. It's not a thing that happens every day. So it can vary from 100 millimeters to 500 millimeters. And in inches, that is 3.9 inches to 19.6 inches. That's annual rainfall throughout a whole year. I know some places will get that in one day. So the other thing, lots of sunshine. If you ever want to come to a place to get some sun, this is the place to come to. And I had to put that picture of Lara. When I mentioned about being sunny, it means you don't get too many clouds around. So we actually went on one of our surveys and Lara spotted the clouds. So we took a photo of it there, as you can see. So sunny and hot in summer, sunny and cold in winter. That's basically a description of what it's like. So winter temperatures can range from 6 Celsius or 42 Fahrenheit in the morning. And don't forget, that's average temperature. It does get a lot below freezing Celsius very often. And then 20 Celsius in the afternoon and 68 Fahrenheit in the afternoon. So that's the kind of way it goes. And you also have to be prepared for things like frozen pipes. And a lot of the water channels you see in the Karoo can be frozen. When I say water channels, I mean like little ponds and stuff can very much, very often have the size of them getting frozen from those very cold nights. Summertime, well, it's summer right here at the moment, and we had a hot day today. And yeah, the mornings can be about 14 Celsius or 57 Fahrenheit and can reach around about 30 Celsius, 86 Fahrenheit in the afternoon. And I mentioned there as well, this is average, of course, so it can reach 40 very easily, 40 Celsius, 104 Fahrenheit, very easily in the summertime. So yeah, that's kind of how it looks. And it's nice to talk about weather because you don't really have too many cloudy days. You can actually count cloudy days on one hand, to be honest. A breathtaking thing to see in the Karoo are the Karoo sunsets. They're very gorgeous. It's something that every sunset is different, because when you get different types of clouds and stuff, you get different rays of pink and oranges. So really a very gorgeous sunset you'll get here in the Karoo. Also very underrated and something special to see.
So this is just kind of a fun story from the field. So speaking about really hot days, one of the days that I was in the field, probably in the heat of the day, having walked about 10 kilometers or 5 miles, I'd run out of water and was thirsty enough to go and take some water out of one of these very oldified water troughs that they use for animals. And because I was so thirsty and hot, I didn't really mind how much algae it was in, which gives you a bit of a sense of how hot and dry it can be here.
Now, to be something I'm very proud of, the Karoo's got the largest population of blue cranes in natural habitat. So the largest population of blue cranes is actually in the Western Cape population down there, where Christie is based. And then where I'm based in the grasslands, that's just the 14% relatively speaking number of cranes back up there. So the Karoo, I'm very proud to say, as I said, now the natural habitat. Very nice to see them in the natural habitats where they do congregate in different times of the year, and we'll get more to that later.
So generally, because the Karoo is quite an undisturbed area, generally the population has been thought to be quite stable. So some research that I've done in the last year or so is taking some of our South African citizen science data, a project called the Coordinated Avifaunal Road Counts. And how these work is some road counts have been set up across the country, and citizen scientists can go out and drive these routes twice a year. And there's a set protocol, and people record all the birds or large birds that they see, and blue cranes are one of them, which gives us a really nice long-term data set to look at in terms of trends. So Sally Hoffmeyer analyzed this data for her PhD, which she finished in 2012. And then I've then been collaborating with her to update this analysis, because this project has been ongoing. So this is some provisional analysis. We're still trying to get the models just right. But here you can see we've got four graphs focusing on the Northern Cape Karoo, which is the northern part of the Karoo, and then the Eastern Cape Karoo, which is in the south. And here we're looking at the counts for winter and summer. So you can see the summer, what you're looking at here is the black line is the trend line for the trend in population that we're seeing. And then in the dots is indicating the raw data, which is in the units cranes per 100 kilometers. And in the blue is indicating basically the confidence intervals of the model. So you can see in the winter that counts are very variable. And as Bradley will mention later, that's because during the winter, blue cranes are flocking, and these positions of these flocks can vary from year to year. So there's a fair amount of variability in these counts, and maybe a little bit less reliable in terms of looking at trends. But if we look at the summer counts, that data looks a lot more reliable and less error. So this makes sense, because during summers when blue cranes are breeding, and blue cranes often return to the same breeding sites. So this data is a little bit, we feel, is a bit more reliable in terms of looking at trends. So generally the blue crane population has looked to be fairly stable, but what's concerning is we're perhaps seeing a little bit of a drop off in numbers. And this correlates with what people who work in the Karoo are saying about blue crane numbers. So we're going to be looking at this data in a little bit more depth and trying to tease apart these trends and see what's really happening with blue crane numbers in the Karoo.
It's also very good to use citizen science like this, because people can obviously identify blue cranes, and also it's a lot of fun for a lot of people. Like a picking basket, jump in the vehicle and take a car count, coordinated avifaunal road count. So when I was living in the Karoo, I plotted all my breeding sites. I was always taking GPS coordinates of them, and this is my map that I have generated from all my breeding sites that I collected. And it's always a lot of fun to look out for them, because obviously the pair, when they are breeding, there's always one on the nest and one walking around. So to try and find that nest is a bit of a not an art, but it's a lot of fun to do that, and to try and plot them is very important, because that's the breeding sites are obviously very important to know where they are, and also from all different points of view, from understanding the type of habitat they're utilizing.
So when we did the Red List review last year, I extracted some of the breeding site monitoring data that Bradley had been collecting. So this is an indication of 3 of the years that he did monitoring. So that's the number of pairs that he monitored and then the number of chicks that they fledged. And you can see on average, over those 3 years, they were fledging on average 0.99 chicks per pair, basically a chick per pair. And if you compare this to the Western Cape, so my breeding monitoring data is showing from the last 2 years that the breeding success isn't great. So it's about 0.549 chicks per pair. So it seems like the breeding success is a little better in the Karoo. And perhaps that is a product of this relatively less disturbed habitat.
It's a great place to breed, definitely for cranes. Very safe as well. This is the bad bits. I don't like talking about this because it's very sad, but these are the threats for cranes in the Karoo, very similar to other various parts of the country. Habitat loss is not as bad of a threat as other parts of the country due to the fact that the Karoo isn't a very good place to plant corn and other types of crops like that. But a lot of people do, when I say habitat loss in this case, it could be making alfalfa lands, which won't be very big because of the lack of water is the main driving factor for agriculture. So there's no point putting up a couple of acres of corn when there's not much water. So that's kind of how it works in that case. But certainly from habitat loss point of view, it could be things like mining that could be taking place, could be other things, development of roads. So it is still definitely a threat in the Karoo. Power lines, unfortunately, are a threat, but there are ways to mitigate that. I'll get into more detail with that later on as well. And then telephone lines, there are still some places with telephone lines where cranes have actually collided with them. Telephone lines are coming down so fast in South Africa, so it's no longer much of a threat. But in some areas, I did work with the company to put up some devices to make more visible, as with the power company does with power lines. Poisoning, oh my word, that's also difficult to describe because it's very sad when it does happen. Most of the time it's accidental, but it does still happen in different places. I don't really know of intentional poisoning. There's no reason to really poison cranes in the Karoo. So mainly accidental, that people could maybe use the wrong poison. For example, busy poisoning things like locusts at the moment, where people are using various types of poisons that are safe. But if some people make their own poisons, which is actually legal to use a different poison for a purpose like locusts when it's not registered for that. And that's exactly for the reason that it could be poisoning birds such as cranes. So that does happen. Then illegal trade and taking birds out of the wild can still happen. Fences, what happens, birds can be entangled in the fence while trying to go through it because a lot of the barbs of the actual fence itself could be thing that they don't really realize that the barb on the fence can hook them. And then they get twisted in it. So unfortunately it does happen. I've actually tried some various types of pipes in some areas to see if it can work, but it only happens on the odd occasion. So there's no point really making a fence safe if it's not going to help. Bedding twine, in some areas, the farmers have to feed the sheep during the dry times, and they may forget to pick up the bedding twine. And what happens, it can be entangled in the feet of cranes, or in some cases, right up to the leg. And they get injured from that and then can possibly die of injuries. Drowning in water troughs, that does happen where the chick especially tries to go into a trough and doesn't realize that it takes a skill to get out of it. And then they just get trapped in the trough itself. It happens to some dams as well, some of these cement dams especially, where the birds just by accident get into the dam, they just can't get out. There are ways to help that as well, by putting some types of rocks or something in the trough or the dam in some cases that the birds can then get onto something to walk to get out of it. So that does happen and is very effective to have some kind of a device. I know some farmers have used like a plank of wood in case it happens as well. So, but most of the time, a rock, a nice flat rock can serve that purpose. Domestic dogs, in some areas where communities are living very close to breeding pairs of cranes, the dogs could wander at nighttime or during the day when the owners are not home, and they could, by accident, catch a chick, which unfortunately does happen in some areas. When I say eggs taken, it's, I don't really know of too many cases at the moment, but in some cases, people are starving. It can happen. But where eggs can be broken is if livestock are in the camp where the cranes are breeding. They don't exactly notice an egg and then can walk right on top of that nest. Because the birds are breeding on the ground, on a bit of a scrape on the ground, which I'll show photos now, it is possible that the livestock don't see that. And then by walking through it, they can break that egg. Then in the Karoo, it's a very popular place at the moment. When I say the moment, this is becoming a very popular place now for new development of wind energy and solar energy. As I mentioned about being a place with a lot of sunshine, it's good to make use of that sunshine. And that's exactly what the people are starting to do now by using renewable energy sources. So a lot of your high-lying areas within the Karoo, you get a lot of wind turbines are popping up now these days, like mushrooms. And we know it is serving that purpose for renewable energy. And then the solar, you get massive solar farms that are also coming up, and existing ones have been around.
So just in terms of what we know so far about the impact of wind farms on birds in general and blue cranes. So this was a study published by some colleagues at UCT and BirdLife. So they looked at the post-monitoring data between 2014 and 2018. Basically, this figure is summarizing the birds that collided with the wind farms and during that time. So we know that blue cranes have been killed by four of the wind farms. So at the moment, not massive numbers. And you can see in the Karoo, in the middle of this map, it's mainly raptors and other passerines that have been affected. There haven't been any blue crane fatalities in the Karoo at this stage. But as Bradley says, a lot more wind farms are planned, and we do need to keep a lookout for this threat going forward.
Now, we also provide comments for a lot of these developments through the environmental impact assessment process. Just to give comments where they must try and avoid areas where there's large concentration of cranes in the winter or the summer. So depending on where they are. So we do give those comments, and it's very effective. And when I mentioned earlier about a lot of these wind farms are in high-lying areas, you don't often get cranes on top of these mountains in the Karoo. So it's one plus at the moment. We hope it stays that way, but it's not a general place you get a flock of cranes flying over a hill. It's just something that there's a lot of the cranes prefer to go in the lower areas and flying through the different like valleys and stuff instead of going over a mountain. I've been doing a transmission power line project with my colleague Ronald Fasaki, who's in that picture over there of us. And this has been ongoing since 2008. We've been studying four transects of power line. These are transmission power lines, as the photo on left suggests there, with an example of, unfortunately, of a blue crane that collided with it. And if you ask Ronald, when you do the full survey of all four transects, you have to go through 95 gates, which can be challenging at times. It's a lot of work to open those gates. And don't forget, some people can have different methods of closing a gate. You know, in other words, it could be a lock, it could be a chain, it could be wire. So it takes an art to get to know how to open gates and how to close gates correctly. And it's a lot of work. And what's happened is that through the research, we've been able to get before and after data, looking at areas where we've marked with different devices. And this is done through the marking, the two types of devices, the spiral that is shown left-hand side where the helicopters mark them, and the right-hand side, the bird flight diverter, we also just simply call them flappers. And through the data we've collected from this project, we've been able to see that these devices definitely work for cranes. It's very effective. Unfortunately, not for the Ludwig's bustard, which is also a large bird that's found in the Karoo. So this shows us now from our research that it's a worthwhile thing to do to mark these. And this is thanks to our electricity supply company known as ESCOM, and through our partnership with the Nature Wildlife Trust, have been able to do this. So a very effective project. It just makes us see just how effective these things can be to make things safer for cranes. And we had a bit of a gap at one stage from 2008, but of a gap of a few months. And we're hoping to get some more devices on these lines very soon as well to now see how that can benefit the Ludwig's buses. These are new devices that will glow in the dark and could possibly help as well in certain cases. Whenever I talk about power lines being affected for cranes in some areas, cranes can be disturbed at different types of day and night and stuff as well. So hopefully these glow in the dark can also help if birds get disturbed at nighttime and don't know there's an existing power line. So it's a very exciting project, and there was a paper published recently, and all the details are below there as well on looking at the research that we've collected. So I'm very passionate about this project because I've been part of my life since 2008, and I've really got to understand how power lines work. I've got to see where hotspots are and understand how things happen. I mean, for example, if you've got a large dam nearby where you know cranes are roosting, that logically says that you will have lots of incidents. And that's exactly what I've been basically like confirming with this project, and just to see the flight paths of cranes, because they have almost like airplanes, they've got specific flight paths where they fly, and you get to know those flight paths from projects such as this. So it's been very exciting, and to see the effectiveness of these flappers to me has been the most exciting, to see how the numbers of cranes have declined, number of plane collisions have declined since the markers were put up is very rewarding to see how it's working. Just some scenery from the power line survey area. So also up and down, a lot of little valleys to go through, some small mountains. And then this is one of the examples of a gate we went through. And there's our national animal on the other side of the gate waiting for us to drive through. So yeah, a national animal and national bird can be found in the Karoo.
So there's been quite a long-standing project looking at the transmission lines, but we know from anecdotal reports and the data that we have so far that blue cranes also collide with these smaller distribution lines. And generally, from previous research in the Western Cape, we find that collisions are higher on transmission lines than distribution lines. But if you have a look at this map, which shows you the power lines in South Africa, in the red, you have the transmission lines, which are the bigger ones, and then in the blue, the distribution lines. And you can see that the density of distribution lines is very high. So overall, the distribution lines can have quite a big impact on blue cranes. So part of my PhD was to have a look at quantifying this threat. So what we did is we set up 8 transects across the most important area for blue cranes in the Karoo. Each of these transects is 20 kilometers or 12 miles long. And what we do is we walk underneath the power line and basically record anything that we come across, a blue crane or a bustard or any other bird that's flown into it. And we do these surveys on a quarterly basis. We started it in July 2019, and we are currently up here in the Karoo doing our final survey. So watch this space. Within the next year or so, we're going to be analyzing the data, and it'll give us a bit of a better idea of how much of an impact distribution lines are having on blue cranes.
Like Christy said, that's exactly why we're all together at the moment. So we're helping Christy with these surveys. And Tan and Laura went out on their survey today, the one that's called the R there, because we're in the R at the moment. And I actually went into the transmission line today with Renan. So that's what we're here for. We'll be doing the next surveys over a couple of days, as you can see on the map there. So very excited about that. It's a nice walk. It's a beautiful area to go through. And also to collect this data is very important, and you know that it's going to be worthwhile to get this data. And there's a picture of us on one of the sections. When we say we're walking surveys, it's not just flat the whole time. You can see that's us on top of the one ridge that we walked up. And Christy is brave. She's much faster up and down in those sort of sections than what I am. So yeah, that's one of our strong points. We can have races and see who gets to one point before the other person. So that's one of our scenes. That's known as the New Bethesda region. That's between Graaffreinet and Middelburg in the Eastern Cape. Very hilly area and absolutely spectacular areas to look at. So that's why we were very proud when we got to that point to take a photo and look down on that valley itself. Awesome place to look at. And then this, I had to put this in as well. Okay, so in Afrikaans, the gate over there says Klim oor hierdie hek en jy is vrek. What that literally means in English, it says, if you climb over this gate, you will die. So we put it to the test, and we actually both came out alive. So we were just to test the water a bit there. So through this whole process, we go through private lands all the time. These are owned by private landowners. And when we met this farmer on this farm, he's actually very friendly, and it's actually surprising to put something like that up on his gate because he's very welcoming. But we just had to be naughty there and get some photos like that just to show people in presentations like this today. So it's really great to meet people on these things, and we just have to always respect the fact we're going on privately owned land and just always get permission from these people. And we have a fantastic relationship with these farmers in this area. So we're getting a lot of support from them, and it's just good to note that and to always know we're on private owned land. Moving on to breeding cranes, this is the exciting bit now. So cranes nests can vary in different types. So you can either have stones, a collection of stones, simply just a scrape in the ground with nothing around it, just on flat on the ground. You can have a couple of sticks and stones, and in some cases, even some sheep droppings. So there's a classic example on the left-hand side there where the two eggs are. They've got all of them, basically. We've got the sticks, stones, and sheep dropping. You know, those black things are sheep droppings. And then on the right-hand side, an example of an island pair. So they want to be an island pair. They want to live on an island. And then they make a nest next to that surface water in that little pond in that area. And it's actually amazing because I've actually watched a couple of chicks in areas like this. Those chicks learn to swim, stroke, walk through water straight away as they hatch. It's actually amazing to see how they just get out the egg and they just walk across like that in the dam, like as if nothing's happened. Like, wow. I mean, it's just absolutely amazing how cranes can be in a place like that. So also a spectacular thing to see some chicks that hatch near a place like that. It's really awesome. So I've really been spoiled by things that I have seen in the Karoo, and that's definitely one type of event that I'll never forget, seeing chicks, little fluff balls like this, going across a little dam like that. And it's, for them, us look huge, and to us looks like a small dam, but very cute, lovely to see. And I must say, I don't like saying I've got favorite pairs of cranes because I want to be really biased. But the top pair in that, where just underneath the words breeding cranes, I think is my favorite pair. That's because I got to know them so well. And I think they got to know me as well because I'd stop and watch them all the time. I've watched them for hours, and they're just a perfect example of a crane pair. So you can see the two adults there with the two chicks in the middle, protecting their two chicks as best as possible. This is the grassy Karoo section, so it's very close to where I live, and that's why I say it's one of my favorite pairs, because I got to know them so well because they're so close. But just to watch their behavior was very amazing for me to see that. Then on the left-hand side, you can see a classic example of a crane adult that's now doing a bit of a broken wing thing, where it's trying to get my attention away from the chick and, you know, say, rather catch me than my chick, please. No, not my chick. And that's, so his wings are fine, he can fly, but he's just making as though he's got a broken wing to get my attention off his chick. And there's another example on the left and bottom right as well. You can see the chicks are with their parents. Very, very good parents. If you want any advice on parenting, look at some crane parents. They're fantastic. And just the way that they protect their chicks is just amazing. I mean, to walk around with a broken wing thing like that is just amazing. Do you have all that courage to see a human being that was trying to catch you instead of your chick? I mean, that's just spectacular. And I'm not even saying, ah, oh, cute. Come on, I'm sure you have to say that. This is a really cute picture. And this is showing you how these are Karoo, we call them Karoo bushes that you find in the Karoo. So it's not dominated by grasses. It's dominated by these little tiny shrubs. Now, the way the chicks, the way that they can hide away is to literally get themselves either into a bush or, in this case, right underneath it. So this is a very young chick that I saw while going past a pair. And then this, in many cases, when I've been out to areas, those chicks disappear quickly and you never see them again. So they're very good. That's the way of hiding away. And it's really cute. I was very, very touched by this one over here. And I still love looking at this photo. I'm going to share a video now. We'll see how long we want to go into it, because it's actually quite a long video. This is what Christie and I actually saw last year when we were together in the Karoo. And this also just shows you how these two are just absolutely amazing, the way they're dancing for each other. I mean, to do this for such a long time, like, this is a very spectacular, lovely thing to watch. I actually didn't notice that I got this on video until just the other day, to be honest, when I was looking through my videos and discovered that actually this is not a bad video, because now you can see how the male and female, how they interact with each other. They'll pick up a stone and then try and do the dance. I promise you, Chris and I were together with this. We just love watching this spoonery together. It was just so amazing. They did this right next to us. This is literally just a few yards away. And very often the cranes in the Karoo are actually very shy. They like to be further away from people as other parts of the country. And I mean, these ones are right there by us. I think they're just so proud and just showing us, you know, what they could do. I mean, for human beings, I mean, they can take their wife for a movie or something, but being cranes, they have to do this to strengthen their bond all the time and, you know, keep the relationship strong and just show their love for each other. I think this is really amazing. It's something that I promise you, to watch this video, I can actually let it go on for longer because it's really amazing just to watch it. I mean, this is what shows you what a craniac is like. Now, craniac means that you love cranes, and to see a thing like this is just amazing. And anytime you see a thing like this, you enjoy and you appreciate, because it just shows you the character of cranes, that they dance for each other. And the way that they do that all the time is in breeding season. It's just absolutely spectacular. So I love this. I promise you, I've stopped my vehicle many times to watch this happening. I've been driving in the Karoo. You just can't just drive past a pair like this and not stop and look at them. It's absolutely amazing. So we can play again, but I think we'll move on to the next slide. So cranes like shallow water in dams, ponds like this, where they like to roost at nighttime. This is for safety in numbers. And in some cases, there's been up to sometimes like 600, 700 cranes I've counted on some big roost sites. I haven't seen numbers like that. Okay, I haven't been doing monitoring of them lately, but I haven't seen enough water like some of the big ponds that we've had in the past in that kind of situation. But if you go to these places afterwards, you'll always see the remnants of the feathers and their footprints there. But it's also an amazing thing to see because now you've got the beautiful sunset that I mentioned earlier. They've got a whole flock of cranes coming into roost. And it's amazing how they all do it together. They will come together and they know exactly where the dam is because they just fly there just out of nowhere. You see them come flying in. So it's lovely. It's also a place for safety. Obviously, they feel good there for that point of view. Winter time is tricky in the Karoo because it's nice to see them in natural habitat. In some cases, they could go to these alfalfa, also known as lucerne lands, for the winter time, where they're basically going to be looking around for insects, whatever they can find around on those land. And also in most cases around other types of birds, such as in the right-hand side photo, you'll see Egyptian goose there. And they often come in large numbers. It could be up to 200 Egyptian geese and a flock of, let's say, 120 blue cranes. So they often are together. And in this case, this is actually a group that I saw last year. And one of them has got some bands on it. You'll see those color bands on it, which I was very chuffed to see because we haven't done much rigging in the Karoo lately. So it was nice to see one that was rigged, that was banded quite a while ago. Unfortunately, some cranes could be a bit too numerous in some lands. I did get some complaints of cranes, not serious damage, but just some farmers requested to be better off the land. So this photo here shows a little flock of cranes that I put up these droppers, the fence droppers on them. Well, let's just call it poles, because they're basically just poles, with some of the danger tape to what happens when the danger tape moves with a bit of a breeze. It scares the cranes. And this is also a case where you can see the power line at the top, where you can see that they have been marked with those devices to make it more visible for the cranes when they do fly in and out of these lands. In most cases, that danger tape did work to get the cranes off the land. And it's something that does happen. It's not really feeding on the alfalfa because it's usually established lands. It's very often large birds in numbers where there could be trampling of the newly growing alfalfa from short growing, how do you say, like not too tall alfalfa, because when it's a bush like this of alfalfa, they're not going to get in there. They want the shorter ones. So I did get a couple of complaints, and it's not serious as it looks there, but they do often come in numbers where they could be a bit too numerous for some farmers. I had to go help. Okay. Other methods we use is to use things like gas cannons in some cases, but also simply getting someone to crack a whip would often get the cranes to move off those lands. And because these cranes, you've got to use that to your advantage, the fact that they're scared of people, that the minute you get to them, I mean, this was taken through a zoom lens, I suppose, but when you see a person drive up to lands, they will fly away because they are scared of people. So use that to your advantage and get someone to walk there with a whip and just crack a whip. I mean, it often scares the cranes in most cases. And then looking at them in the natural habitat in the winter is very, very special for me. This was a cold day in the Karoo, and this is more like a mist, not really clouds, but it was a day, I just remember this day being freezing cold and seeing a group like that. I was like, I know you guys are cold because I'm cold. So that was, it's really amazing. What happens, the birds like to go into the Karoo felt in wintertime. They feed on these tiny bulbs that are really, really small. And that's their natural food, because obviously in summertime, they're feeding mainly on insects that they can find at that time of the year. And when it becomes winter, they like to eat these sort of small bulbs that you will get in a place like this where the photo is taken. And I've once been to a farm before where I counted over 1,000 cranes in one section. And I actually had to stop counting. I had a little sheep counter. I was busy clicking on my sheep counter the whole time. And I got to 999. And I said, okay, I'm going to stop because now it's getting a bit too much to guess how many there are after seeing 1,000. Because what happens, the birds are also moving around a bit too much. So to get an accurate figure was actually impossible. But I'll never forget that day. It was a very special moment for me to see so many birds in natural habitat on the farm. And that was in wintertime a few years back. Absolutely amazing thing to see. So just to show you how there aren't flocks in wintertime, and a nice scenery there with some of the Karoo mountain in the background. Then last year, June 2020, we were lucky enough to see some snow in the Karoo. And that's just one of the farms on the left-hand side with some geese that were basically floating on the ice there. And then one of the other little ponds on the right-hand side was some bit of snow that was still there the morning after. And then the background picture here, you can see some snow falling, but it's not as impressive because the snow often melts when it reaches the ground. So it's not as spectacular as I'm sure it is now at the moment in Wisconsin and various parts of America that is thick in snow, as I've been hearing from ICF colleagues and other people in America. So yeah, that's not quite as thick as there, but you don't often see snow in the Karoo. So this is a very special moment for us. We absolutely loved it. We couldn't build a snowman, unfortunately. We'll have to work on that for another winter when it does snow properly, maybe. But that was just absolutely awesome. Very good memory for us to remember June 2020. And I promise you, that photo on the right-hand side, come on, you've got to say that's beautiful for something like that. So when I get back to my threats of cranes in the Karoo, when I was living here, I did a lot of work on awareness, especially because it's very important to get that message out there to school learners, especially in farm schools. You know, get the learners to understand, because in some farms, when I mentioned you can get 1,000 cranes, in some areas you could have maybe 3 or 4 breeding pairs on the farm. Now what happens is that the cranes use a lot of farm camps. Because the camps here are fairly large, they will use that whole entire camp to make a nest and to breed and everything. And that means that it gives opportunity for people to think that there's loads of cranes. And to get this awareness out there for the learners, the children to understand that there actually aren't that many cranes in the world and we have to protect them, it's very important to get that spark at that age to understand. The same with farm workers, because farm workers are on the farm all the time. This is one farm worker workshop that I held. So I took the picture, which is why I'm not in that picture. So that was my crane that went everywhere with me when I did education awareness. He was taxidermied, so I didn't have to feed him that much. And he's very famous because he went everywhere with me. And a lot of, I promise you, when I went to some of the schools, those children, when they saw their laughing faces, like, oh, what's happening? And I'm like, don't worry, this crane is here for display purposes. He's not going to eat you up. So it was a nice way just to show people what a crane looks like. Because also some people get confused between various species, because we also have birds such as herons here, for example. So that just to get that out there, what to look out for. So I discussed a lot of the threats, and I promise you the farm workers I worked with were absolutely amazing. I got a lot of information because the farmers would then relay that information to me from power line collisions or in some cases fence entanglements or injured birds in some cases. So they were aware of what to look out for, and also obviously from that get that love for cranes and, you know, not to do anything bad for them on the farm that they're working on. Also, this is the one aerial survey I did looking for cranes. This was done in December time, which is the breeding season for cranes in the Karoo. So we weren't specifically looking out for numbers of cranes, as you would do for a lot of surveys to count cranes from different points and look for flocks. This was mainly looking for breeding pairs to then go back on the ground and to check up on that pair, how they're doing, how many chicks are there, how many hatched. So primarily to look for breeding sites. And this is just one little flock of cranes, a little bachelor flock. that we saw from the air when I did this. So like I said, December, and that was me a lot younger than what I am now. And that was the pilot that was with me. That was courtesy of the Bacheliers, which is it's an NGO that helps us with bird counts such as this in this case. But a great time. I got to see various parts of the Karoo from near where I live, from the air, which was absolutely amazing. That was a really spectacular day. I'll never forget that day at all. It was really amazing. And then banding cranes, obviously very important for research purposes to see how far they go. And you'll see on the crane on the right-hand side, for the Northern Cape province, where we are currently in the moment, if you band cranes here, you'll put on the one leg, you'll put a red over white. And that's to indicate that you're in the province for it. And then the other unique combination we'll have, for example, there, you've got the yellow, red, green. And we usually just have a long red ring, or for the right hand, for in this case, would be the right hand bird. But now, because the ring combinations are now running out, it's become the red over white. Then, for example, as well, the Eastern Cape province, which is nearby here, where there's also Karoo, the band for them is the yellow band. So, a lot of fun. And I did see a lot of ring banded cranes in the wintertime as well, especially when they go to flocks to see them. It's always interesting. And I also noticed a lot of them were sort of going within a few miles away from the breeding sites, not too far. But this is what's very interesting about Christie's research, to actually get proper satellite data from that.
So this was what we wanted to do, is have a look at slightly more detailed movements. So from banding or ringing, you can get kind of once off when the cranes are resighted, but satellite trackers give you very detailed data, which is really valuable. So we put some satellite trackers on pre-fledging chicks in 2019. And here you can see two siblings that we trackers and rings on. So just like with the ring combination, we put a combination of three rings on the one leg, and on the other leg, it was a leg-based tracker. So we fitted 11 juveniles in the Karoo. Unfortunately, these trackers haven't worked as well as we'd hoped they would, but they've still given us some really good data of what blue cranes do in their first year. So these are the movements from these two siblings that we fitted in the New Bethesda area. So this is the first year that they were fitted, is when we were getting relatively good data. And you can see they moved around quite locally. This is probably about 5 kilometers or 2.5 miles from north to south. And you can see they make fairly localized movements within the area that they were hatched and raised.
And I must say, it's also to a lot of people I have to thank, you know, for these sort of things, but I think I have to put a big thank you to all the Karoo landowners out there. I think it's very important, because the relationships that I've built with these landowners is incredible. It's something that I keep a lot of this relationship going with a lot of these landowners, because we get a lot of information from them. Yesterday I heard from a Karoo landowner, which is where those two chicks were actually banded with the satellite trackers. I heard from him yesterday. So we keep in touch with a lot of information from them on an ongoing basis. And I mean, I really appreciate that. It's been fantastic to get to know these landowners over my 8 years in the Karoo. And I mean, the people are so friendly in the Karoo. It's one of those situations where you go around a farm and the landowner will take you around, show you different parts of his farm, show you where the birds are breeding. Fantastic, friendly people, amazing. And I really appreciate all of that. So, I mean, it's something that we just can't go without. Because if you think about it, 99% of blue cranes actually occur in privately owned land. And these are our custodians of the cranes in South Africa. So that's me presenting one of the crane custodian boards to one of the landowners. And then I had to also put a picture of one of the Karoo school students who did some artwork of a crane, it's always special to see children busy drawing these sort of pictures of cranes. It's amazing just how they comprehend and see what a crane looks like through their eyes. Most of the time, these cranes are drawn out of their heads. It's just spectacular. So the Karoo is an absolutely amazing place. I also want to thank you for attending. We're going to get to some questions very soon, and we'll start them now, where Tanya will be helping us with questions. But please, if you guys have any additional questions that you'd like to get to, please email us. We've got all our details at the bottom there for emailing. And you're welcome to get in touch with us. We'll answer your questions if you don't answer them now. And you're also welcome to contact us for any more information about the Karoo. I love this place. I'll be very biased towards it and also give you a lot of advice on where to go if you want to come there. So awesome place. We're going to get to questions very soon, but also I just want to just thank International Crane Foundation for everything they do and also to Hannah for arranging today's From the Field webinar. So Tanya, please get some questions and please only easy questions.
Sure, no problem, Bradley. Firstly though, well done guys, Bradley and Christie, great job. We've got some really awesome questions here for you. I have answered some of the other questions, so we'll hit you with a few. Let's kick off with a question from Kathleen. It's a great question, and probably to you, Christie, particularly focused on your slide where you were looking at the comparison of breeding success between the Karoo and the other parts of South Africa. Kathleen's question is, what would be a sustainable fledging success number or breeding success? What would you expect the fledging success to be for it to sustain a growing population?
So this is actually one of the main outputs of my PhD, is to do some population modeling to look at, it very much depends on what's happening in the population in terms of mortality and other factors. So basically what I plan to do at the end of my PhD is to do some population modeling and to figure out what an ideal breeding success rate is. So we're not too sure at the moment, but hopefully in the next 2 years, we're going to have a better idea of what the ideal is.
Awesome. Thanks, Christie. So linked to chicks, I suppose, and understanding breeding success, we have a bit more of a practical question here. And Brad, maybe it's to you, considering you an incredibly experienced crane catcher. But we have a question here from Jane asking, how do you actually catch the cranes to fit the colorings to?
Yeah, it takes running, but what happens when you see the chicks, you only go for ones of a certain height. They must be, you know, definitely the right age and the right height to catch. You're not going to go for the small chicks. So they must almost be just before they're about to fly. So they're strong enough and they must definitely be blue in color. So you're not going to band a chick that's still brown in any way brown. So you literally have to run for them, but very often those chicks will then hide in the Karoo bush, almost like that small one I had, but now a blue chick, and then you run up to them and bring them back and then band them. So it takes, I also have a cutoff as to how far I will run after them if I do have to run, because sometimes they will maybe stand up and then do a little dance and stuff. But if they're going to run too far, I'll definitely stop at a certain point and say, okay, you guys are too far away, I don't want to tire you guys out. So it must be I'm very strict about that. They're not going to run too far and tire them out. It mustn't be at all stressful for the bird. They must be relaxed and then catching them to put their bands on. It's done very well. And it's like I said, the cranes have to be strong in that case. So it takes fast running, I'm proud to say. So
we need Bradley's on the team. I'm not fast enough.
Yeah, for sure. So for those of you who don't know Bradley, he is an avid runner, so he is very useful to have on the team for catching blue crane chicks. So yeah, you definitely, to catch cranes, you need at least 1 to 2 people that are fairly fit and able to traverse pretty difficult terrain, as you guys saw in the photos there. So still on sort of breeding, we have a question around just trying to understand when is the breeding season for blue cranes in South Africa, or specifically the mating time. Either one of you guys can answer that?
The start of the Western Cape, because they're like first ones, because the Western Cape start first.
Yeah, Western Cape starts a bit earlier than the Karoo, so typically it's obviously a bit varied, so some pairs will start earlier than others. From about September, October, you'll start seeing cranes pairing off and starting to defend the territory. By about November, that's probably the peak time that cranes are breeding in the Western Cape. And then about now until May, you'll have the fledglings start to leave or become flighted. So that's typically kind of your window for breeding with blue cranes in the Western Cape.
Right, so for the Karoo, it's very dependent on water because of the rain that comes here. So what I've what I found out when I was living here, probably about 2 weeks after the first rains start. So the first rains can maybe start in, it could be December, it could even be January in some cases, but very often be like, when the rain starts, I'm talking about proper rain. I mean, one little shower of a few drops is not going to count. But when proper rain comes in, which just to get the actual area wet enough for the place to change over. Let me go back to the word rain here again, because I haven't actually said anything about the way that this place changes. Because a dry season is a winter time, and you get into the rainy season, which is summertime, the first rain you have, you see an amazing difference in the Karoo, literally overnight, where you get the actual Karoo bushes could be like a gray color. Next morning after rain, green. And I can tell you that is absolutely awesome to see. And you get a fresh smell afterwards as well, real Karoo bush smell after a rain like that. Anyway, so back to breeding. So what happens after the rains will set in about 2 weeks later, you often see some birds pairing off to start breeding. And then the incubation period is 30 days, so roughly a month, and then you start seeing the chicks hatch. I mean, like now today I saw two beautiful chicks that are nice, typical February sort of size that were almost ringable, that were, you know, this 45 centimeters sort of high, a nice knee height sort of height. And yeah, they were already there. But then I saw another two pairs today that were, when I say pairs, I just saw two single birds that they could still be breeding. It is still possible for them to be breeding now, even though we'll be going into the fall quite soon, into autumn quite soon, in the end of March. So it's just something to bear in mind that these cranes are very dependent on rain. So when the rain starts, these insects, they're going to give that high protein diet for the chicks as well. So that's why they're going to wait for the rain to come, that they can feed them the little locusts or whatever they can get for the chicks.
Awesome. Thanks, Brad. So guys, we've got two great questions here that you'll need to apply your minds to. So firstly, we have a question here from Diana, really wanting to know a little bit more around the role of landowners in crane conservation and farmers, and what work has been done to engage with landowners around education awareness. And so just if you guys can just elaborate a little bit more around that, it would be really great.
Yeah, I'll start from my Karoo point of view. It's very important that the landowners also understand, you know, where cranes feature and how they are custodians of the natural habitat version of cranes, and that when they see them in large number, that they are also on the red data book. That's very important to understand where they come from. So that's the first start. I've been to many farmers' meetings where I presented a short presentation on, you know, what the importance is of cranes. Now, being a national bird, that a farmer must feel that he's special to have a custodian of crane on his farm. And that's very important that from that, he can then start reporting things like power line collisions, breeding pairs. So a bit of both worlds, from birds that are starting to breed on the farm through to any kind of mortalities, that I can get that information, try and prevent in the future. So if there was a collision, for example, of a blue crane on a power line, then we get the electric supply company Eskom to come out and then fit those devices to make more visible for the cranes. And then any other information that the farmers, I mean, I've got a wealth of information from the farmers, and it's always important to keep in contact with them and get information from an ongoing basis. I mean, I appreciate all the stuff that they've got from them. So I have to ask you a question, because I can talk about this for hours. I've got so many examples of different, I've been onto some farmers as well. So, but yeah, good question. It's
cool. Yeah, boring. And you don't have hours. Sorry, Bradley. We wish you did, though. Cool. So we have a great sort of last question from the floor for you guys, and then I have a question for you. But the last question from Glenn is, what are the main climate change factors affecting the region, and how are those anticipated to affect cranes? So really, really great question, and I know Christie's probably itching to answer this one.
So in the Karoo, there has been some research couple of years ago that they had a look at how climate was affecting survival. It was a paper by Altwick and Anderson. And what they predicted is that the timing of rainfall could change, which I'm trying to remember exactly from the paper, but they said if the early rainfall became higher, that could be of benefit to cranes because breeding success would then increase. So in the Karoo, most of the climate change models indicate that there's potentially going to be a change in the type of rainfall that we're seeing. So it's difficult to predict how that could affect cranes. It could benefit them or it could be to their detriment, but we'll have to monitor and see how cranes react as climate changes.
Brilliant. Thanks, Christie. Thanks, Bradley. So I think the last question, just to end off, for those that are watching live and will be watching this webinar later, I'm sure many of them have asked themselves how they could contribute or get involved. Do you guys have some thoughts around how people can get involved and support the work that you guys have presented here or the work of ICF in general?
Yeah, great question. I mean, I think everybody can do their bit for birds conservation around the world by just appreciating them. Number one thing, I mean, we're all proud to see birds wherever we go. I mean, even if you take part in some kind of a citizen science project where you are, it's also fantastic. And from the International Crane Foundation, just bear in mind that we are an NGO and we donor supported. So please, we'll appreciate any kind of donation. It will be really appreciated. And also, you're welcome to become a member of the International Crane Foundation. So please look up for more information on the savingcranes.org webpage. And it would be great to hear from you guys as well. Please also, like we said, our email addresses are there. You're also very welcome to contact us for any more information that you request to have. And also, we just want to thank our sponsors once again, yeah, to Lynn and Chuck Gibbons. Really appreciate it. It's been fantastic. And also, please also, when you also sponsor more webinars, please get in contact with Kate Fitzwilliams. All the details on the screen right now. So join us next time, 2 weeks time, March 4, 11 a.m. Central Time. And that's Carl Tainter will be doing the presentation. So please register as soon as you can on the savingcranes.org website. And thanks so much for attending today's presentation. Really appreciate it. I'm sure I can talk for another 5 hours about the Karoo. I've got so many stories to tell, but I think I have to say goodbye now. So thanks for joining us. And thanks to Christie. And we really appreciate it.
Thanks so much for joining us. And thanks for your time.
Have a great day, everybody.